into the programmable DSP. So several manufacturers will fabricate this DSP processors. One is Texas Instruments, the other is Analog Devices and Motorola. So these three will manufacture the DSP chips. Okay, and due to the complexity, these manufacturers develop a wide range of DSP processors. And this DSP family, what we consider as DMS 320 family, consists of two types of single DSP chips. One is 16-bit fixed point and 32-bit floating point. So we have two different types of DSP processors which are fabricated by this Analog and Texas Instruments. Here, whatever we consider TMS 320 belongs to Texas Instruments. So these DSPs possess the operational flexibility of high-speed controlling operations. So any high-speed controllers can be designed using this DSP processor and its numeric capability. So this is the advantage of using the TMS 320 processor. Then coming to the commercial DSP, there are several families of commercial DSP devices. So from earlier 80s, we can see that the evolution of the processor has begun. And they are widely used for numerous applications such as communication, process control, computers, instrumentation, and consumer electronics. So this is normally control is nothing but a process control used in robotics, and communication, the lines what we normally use for any signal transmission, and this is about a computer where we come across the DSP processors, and consumer electronics, so all the electronic devices which are used as such as the system for any applications, we consider it as consumer products. Then when we look into the architectural feature, we look into the processing power of these devices, and they are constantly upgraded whenever there is an advance in technology and application need. So we have several basic versions of a DSP processor which have Harvard architecture, which has got a single cycle hardware multiplier, an address generation unit with dedicated address registers, and also consists of special addressing modes on chip peripheral interfaces. So of the various families what we consider from Motorola, Texas and Analog Devices, we come across three famous or popular ones, this DSP devices fabricated from Texas, Motorola and Analog Devices. So now we look into the comparison of these three devices in detail. So this is the architectural features of three fixed points DSPs. So first is about the architectural frame. We have a data representation format, so that is what we consider in the architecture. So data representation format of TMS 320 C25 processor, that is a DSP fabricated using Texas Instruments, is used for representing a data in 16-bit fixed point format. Whereas in a DSP which is fabricated as DSP 56000, that is supporting 24-bit fixed point format, and ADSP 2100, that is from the Analog Devices, so this is from the Motorola, this is from the Analog Devices which supports 16-bit fixed point format. So this is about the data format representation, what we use as a architectural feature of these three processors. Coming to the hardware multiplier, we use 16x16 multiplier. Here it is 24x24, and for the Analog it is again 16x16. And ALU, which normally used to perform arithmetic and logical operations in a processor, will have 32 bits supported by the Texas Instrument processor, followed by 56 bits for the processor from Motorola, and 40 bits from the Analog Devices. And coming to the internal and external buses, again they are different. Internal buses, it is 16-bit program bus and 16-bit data bus, which is for a Texas Instrument, and Motorola, it is 24-bit program bus, and two 24-bit data buses are used in the Motorola fabricated DSP device, and 24-bit global data bus, which is a separate bus or additional bus used in a DSP fabricated from Motorola. And coming to the Analog Devices, it is again 24-bit program bus followed by 16-bit data and 16-bit result buses. So this is about the internal buses of the processors. Coming to the external buses, we have 16-bit program or data bus under Texas, 24-bit program or data bus under Motorola, 24-bit program bus and 16-bit data bus under analog devices. Coming to the on-chip memory used in the processor, we have 544 words RAM used in a Texas Instrument fabricated processor, 4K words ROM. Similarly, with the Motorola fabricated DSP device, we have 512 words PROM, then 256 words data RAM, and again 256 words data ROM. And this is not available in analog device fabricated DSP processor. Then about the off-chip memory, we have 64K words program, we have 64K words data under Texas, and 64K words program and 264K words data under Motorola, and again 16K words program and 16K words data under analog devices. So this is very less compared to these two fabricators. Coming to the cache memory is not available in these two. And when we consider the analog device fabricated device, we have 16 words program. Then coming to the instruction cycle time, we have 100 nanosecond instruction cycle time for a Texas Instrument DSP, and 97.5 nanosecond, which is lesser compared to this, and 125 nanosecond, which is greater among all these three fabricators. Then we have special addressing modes. So special addressing modes used here is bit reverse addressing mode in Texas, and modulo bit reversed in Motorola, and modulo bit reversed again under the analog devices. Then the data address modes are 1, 2 and 2. Then interfacing features, what we have is synchronous serial IO and DMA direct memory access, and synchronous and asynchronous serial IO DMA in case of Motorola fabricated DSP, and DMA, which is direct memory access under the analog devices. Then the architecture of TMS320C54 processor. So this is a DSP what we normally consider here for any programming example along with the instruction set. So the functional block diagram of TMS, we can observe we have one program memory and three data memory spaces with separate buses, which is providing simultaneous access to a program instruction and two data operands. So this is the benefit of having one program and three data memory spaces, which is acting as a dual memory units in the TMS320 processor, and it enables writing of a result at the same time. So it is going to use the program, it is going to use the data, and along with that it is also used to write a result. So this is done at the same time. So that is normally using one program and three data memory spaces. So part of the memory is implemented on chip and consists of a combination of ROM and a RAM, and this RAM is again are of two types, dual access RAM and single access RAM. Then so here in this TMS320 processor, transfers between the memory is possible. So which was a drawback when we consider any conventional microprocessor, the transfer between the memory was not possible, whereas here transfers between the memory spaces are also possible. Then a CPU of this TMS320 processor consists of several units. One is ALU, that is arithmetic and logic unit, and it consists of 40-bit ALU, and it has got two accumulators, and those two accumulators are of 40-bit wide, and a barrel shifter, and a multiplier which is having 17 cross 17 space, and a 40-bit adder, and DGEN, that is a data address generation logic with its own arithmetic unit, and PAGEN is nothing but program address generation logic. So one is a data address generation logic, which is abbreviated as DGEN, and the other program address generation logic, which is PAGEN. So these are the two address generation logic units in a CPU of TMS320 processor. Then the functional units are supported by a wide range of registers, and here if I consider the registers, we have the registers renamed or named as auxiliary registers, so ARs. So ARs are used here in order to store the value, in order to fetch the value and perform any addition or multiplication operation, and also for storing the result. So a powerful instruction set with a hardware supported single instruction repeat and block repeat operation, block move instructions, instructions that can pack two or three simultaneous reads, and arithmetic instructions with parallel store and load. So these are the operations which are supported under a instruction set. So it has got a very powerful instruction set in comparison with the conventional microprocessor. And it is also very efficient, which can run a very high speed DSP algorithm. So that is a benefit of using TMS320 C54 processor. And also several peripherals can also be connected to this particular DSP processor. So such as a clock generator, a hardware timer, a wait state generator, parallel I/O ports, serial I/O ports. So these are the peripherals which can also be used along with the processor. Then these peripherals make it convenient to interface the signal processor to the outside world. So the whatever interface we are going to make using the processor, so that can be done with any of these peripherals. Then so in this we can see that this is the functional architecture of a TMS320 processor, which includes all the units what I just said you, that is multiplier, parallel shifter, registers, and address buses, data buses, memory units, and the accumulators. So these are the architectural blocks what we can see under this TMS320. Then we have multiple buses which can provide simultaneous access to various parts of a memory or peripherals. So the performance of a processor will be enhanced due to the multiple buses which are available in the architecture. Then the architecture is built around four pairs of 16-bit buses, with each pair consisting of an address bus and data bus. So this architecture will have four pairs of 16-bit buses, and each pair will have an address bus and a data bus. So if I consider that, it has got a program bus pair which is called as PAB or PB. So we have two program bus which are considered to be the program bus pairs here, which carries the instruction code from the program memory. And we have three data bus pairs, one is CAB, CB, and DAB, DB, and EAB and EB. So which is interconnected, or which is interconnecting the various units within the central processing unit. So we have one pair of program bus and three pairs of data buses. So this is the bus structure what we consider in this TMS320 processor. Whereas in this we have CAB and CB, and DAB and DB are used to read the data from the data memory, whereas the pair EAB and EB will carry the data to be written to the memory. So one is fetching the data from the memory, it uses two pairs, that is CAB and DAB pairs, whereas EAB pair is used to store the data into the memory, or to be written into the memory. So the 54XX can generate up to two data memory addresses per cycle using the two auxiliary arithmetic units. So this is AR, which is auxiliary register we consider here. So it is labeled as ARAU0 and ARAU1, that is auxiliary register arithmetic unit 1 and auxiliary register arithmetic unit 0. So it is available in the data address generation block. So it enables accessing two operands simultaneously. So that is the advantage of using this ARAU0 and ARAU1. Then the central processing unit will consist of 40-bit ALU, two 40-bit accumulators A and B. So A and B are two accumulators, a barrel shifter, a 17x17-bit multiplier, a 40-bit adder, then a CSSU, that is a compare, select and store unit, and exponent encoder, EXP block, a data address generation unit, DAGN, and a program address generation unit PAGN. So these are the blocks which are contained in the CPU of a TMS 320 processor. Then ALU performs 2's complement arithmetic operations and bit level boolean operations on 16-bit, 32-bit and 40-bit words. So this is the size of the data with which the ALU can perform 2's complement arithmetic operations and bit level boolean operations. It can also function as 2 separate 16-bit ALUs and can perform 2 16 operand bit operations simultaneously. So we'll just look into the functional diagram of ALU. So this is a functional diagram of central processing unit of a TMS processor. So here we can see that the ALU, the CPU consists of a ALU and the registers, just I told you about these registers, and these are the accumulators and these are the flag registers. So OVM, then OVA, OVB, ZDA, ZB, these are the zero flag, overflow flag and overflow and TC, so test condition flag. So these are the several flags what we consider under the CPU of TMS 320 processor. And it has got two accumulators, A and B. And the accumulator is normally divided into three parts. One is having a guard bits from 39 to 32. So this is having a guard bit, 39 to 32. Higher order word having 31 to 16. So that is higher order bit, or here we consider it as word. So again, EL 15 to 0, again it is a lower order word. So bits 15 to 0 is this, and bits 31 to 16 is higher order word, which can be stored and retrieved individually. So whatever data we are going to use, the higher order word and lower order word are being utilized here. So each accumulator is memory mapped and it is partitioned. It can be configured as the destination register. So the guard bits are normally used as a head margin for the computations. So both A and B accumulator will have a same size of lower and higher order words along with the guard bits represented for the accumulators. Then a barrel shifter, it provides the ability to scale the data during an operation, either read or write. So that is the advantage of using a barrel shifter in any unit. So no overhead is required to implement the shift needed for the scaling operation. So that is the use of a barrel shifter. So the shifter can produce a left shift from 0 to 31 bits or a right shift from 0 to 16 bits on any input data. The shift count field of status register, that is ST1, or in the temporary registers T. So T is considered here to be a temporary register which can store the shift count of a status register ST1. So whatever ST1 is going to be acted, so that value is going to be used in the temporary register. So figure shows the functional diagram of a barrel shifter of a processor. So the barrel shifter and the exponent encoder are used to normalize the values of an accumulator. So that is the function of a barrel shifter and the exponent encoder. So they are used normally to normalize the values. So the LSBs of the output are filled with zeros and the MSBs can be either zero filled or sign extended. So depending on the state of the sign extension mode bit in the status register ST1. So ST1 is used to represent the state of the sign extension. So whatever value of ST1 is going to be, either it is 0 or 1, that is dependent on the sign extension, whether the sign has to be extended through the MSB or not. So an additional shift capability enables the processor to perform a numerical scaling. So scaling operation is done using a barrel shifter, it's known fact. Then bit extraction, then extended arithmetic and overflow prevention operations. So these are the additional operations which are carried out in a DSP which is not possible in a conventional microprocessor device. Then this is the functional block diagram of a functional diagram of a barrel shifter. So here we can see that these are the test bit ALU output and CSSU and accumulators here A and B, and we use a multiplexer and sign control bit use XXM. So these are the functional blocks of a barrel shifter. Then comes the multiplier or adder circuit. So this is the kernel of a DSP device, so which is a multiplier or adder bit. So here the multiplier or adder bit of TMS 320 processor performs 17 cross 17 2's complement multiplication with 40 bit addition effectively in a single instruction cycle. So that is the advantage of using a multiplier or adder unit, which is a central processing unit of a DSP, which is a kernel of this DSP device. So in addition to the multiplier and adder, the unit also consists of a control logic, so which is required for all the processor, which is timing and control unit requirement for any processor. So it is for integer and fractional computations and 16-bit compute temporary storage register T. So these are the blocks which are included in a multiplier or adder unit. So figure shows this block diagram. So the compare, select and store unit is a hardware unit specifically incorporated to accelerate the add or compare select operation. And this operation is normally used for Viterbi algorithm, which is used for many signal processing applications. So the exponent encoder unit supports EXP instruction. So later we can look into this EXP instruction under the instruction set of TMS T20 processor, which stores in the T register, which is a temporary register of this TMS processor. And this information is useful while shifting the accumulator content whenever a scaling operation is required.